Good evening. Oh, I haven't been in court all day. I've been here. When the judge comes into court in the District of Massachusetts and says good afternoon or good morning, the lawyers, with more enthusiasm than they really feel, I'm sure, say, you know, good evening, Your Honor. Can we try it again? Good evening. You've made me feel very welcome. I too would like to thank Jonathan Fanton, Robert Rotberg for inviting me to participate in this program tonight. It would be a great honor to be here at the American Academy of Arts and Sciences under any circumstances. When I was 29 and 30 years old, I was a special assistant to Edward Levy, the Attorney General of the United States, in the aftermath of Watergate. It introduced me to the most serious study and practical work concerning how to hold high public officials accountable. Attorney General Levy left the Justice Department, soon after became Jonathan's predecessor as the president of the American Academy. And I remember coming here with him for a stated dinner at which relatively new Justice John Paul Stevens spoke in the late 1970s. So as I said, it would be a great honor to be here under any circumstances. But it's an honor that is significantly enhanced by sharing the podium with Judge Moro. The experience he described in Brazil of a thoroughly or widely corrupt, now proven corrupt, country with high officials who hold office to enrich themselves rather than to serve their citizens is not uncommon. However, Judge Moro is unique and truly courageous. It is controversial to do what he's doing. It's inherently dangerous because powerful political officials and corrupt regimes have close connections with organized crime figures, violent figures. It can be threatening. It can be fatal, as it has been to prosecutors in other countries. And the conclusion of investigations, which are inherently difficult or uncertain, and if they're not successful, at best, those who pursued them are vilified, and the consequences can be more severe. If Judge Moro was not so exceptional, and I'd say unique, I wouldn't be here tonight, because there would be no need for what I want to discuss with you, the creation of an international anti-corruption court. But Judge Moro is beyond exceptional, I'd say unique. If Dr. Rotberg couldn't have got him to speak tonight, I doubt you could have thought of anybody else to invite to fill that slot. Because what's happening in Brazil is largely unprecedented and certainly not paralleled elsewhere in the world. At the end of War and Peace, Tolstoy wrote that the thoughts that have enormous consequences are always simple. And I'd like to explain to you a simple, I hope logical idea that can be easily stated, although not easily achieved. And that is that there is a need for an international anti-corruption court to diminish the devastating consequences of what's coming to be called grand corruption or kleptocracy, the abuse of public office for private profit by a nation's leader. This grand corruption depends on a culture of impunity that exists when corrupt leaders control the administration of justice, the police, the prosecutors, and the courts, and will not permit the honest, effective investigation, prosecution, and punishment of their friends, their families, and indeed themselves. An international anti-corruption court is necessary for almost all of the countries characterized by kleptocracy to create the credible threat of punishment. And punishment is not an end in itself. It serves, we believe, and I think it's been demonstrated, it's more than an article of faith to deter, because corruption is a crime of calculation. And when public officials can calculate that they won't get caught, they won't get prosecuted, they certainly won't be punished, there's nothing to inhibit them from robbing their countries in effect or in fact. And if corrupt public officials are successfully prosecuted, it creates opportunities for the democratic process to operate for all those people who've gone to the streets in Brazil to elect more honest officials who will be dedicated to serving their citizens rather than enriching themselves. This idea of an international anti-corruption court, Joe Nye asked me earlier, where did it come from? I think it's rooted in my experience working for Attorney General Levy after Watergate and prosecuting corrupt state and local officials in federal court, not state court, which is what we do in this country, and to presiding in cases like the case against the Speaker of the House of former Speaker at the time, House of Representatives, Sal DeMacy, as a federal judge. And essentially, the fundamental point that I'd like to make is that for countries that don't have Judge Moro, and that's virtually all in the world, who need such prosecutors and judges, the credible threat of prosecution and punishment is the essential missing link in the effort to combat grand corruption. The International Anti-Corruption Court, I submit, is justified by the devastating costs and consequences of grand corruption or kleptocracy. Both Jonathan Fanton and Robert Rotberg have alluded to some of those costs. I'd reemphasize and perhaps amplify them. Perhaps the most obvious cost is economic. It is estimated that at least $1 trillion a year is paid in bribes. 10 times more is lost to corruption in developing countries than is given in foreign aid. And the problem is not only a problem of developing countries. The World Bank has estimated that 43% of Russia's GDP is lost to its corrupt shadow economy. Russia's in the top three countries in the world that has in its outflow of illicit, illegal capital, and its leaders, I think it's fair to say, contribute a great deal to that. Vladimir Putin's daughter owns a good deal of Moscow. When the Panama Papers came out, it was revealed that Vladimir Putin's best friend, cellist Sergei Rolgovin, is doing even better than my very good friend and very good cellist, Yo-Yo Ma. Putin's best friend argued the year before the Panama Papers that he should not be on the sanctions list of people prohibited from coming to the United States because he wasn't even a millionaire, struggling musician. Panama Papers showed that on paper, he was worth billions of dollars. And it's widely inferred that he is the straw for Vladimir Putin with regard to these enormous assets. More recently, Alexei Navalny, a great foe of corruption in Russia, revealed that the prime minister, Dmitry Medvedev, owns expensive properties throughout Russia and has properties in Tuscany and yachts there as well. Corruption breeds constituents for terrorists. The primary constituents, the supporters of Boko Haram in Nigeria, the Taliban in Afghanistan, for example, are not religious fanatics. They're people who support those organizations because those organizations have positioned themselves as the foes of the corrupt leaders in their capitals. There's also an almost complete correlation between the countries that are most abusive of their citizens' human rights and those which are led by essentially demonstrably corrupt officials. They include Somalia, Afghanistan, Syria, Iran. And it's very important to recognize internationally, as it is in the United States, that corruption is not a victimless crime. Some of you may have read yesterday the article in the New York Times about Angola's corrupt building boom. I mean, interestingly, Judge Moro deserves a lot of credit for that article, too. It revealed that Odebrecht, the company that he's been investigating and prosecuting, along with prosecutors in Brooklyn here under our Foreign Corrupt Practices Act, has paid at least $50 million of bribes to people, of high officials in Angola. What the article didn't do, though, is the following. It did point out that the president of Angola's daughter, Isabel dos Santos, is known to be the richest woman in Africa. She's worth at least $3 billion. But the article didn't point out that Angola, which is a wealthy country, great oil interests among others, Angola has the highest percentage of children who don't live to the age of five. It's not because there are no resources to provide medical care. It's because the people who hold public office are dedicated to enriching themselves and indifferent to the health and welfare of their citizens. Grand corruption invariably undermines democracy. As I said, kleptocrats hold office to enrich themselves, not to serve their citizens. They have to suppress civil society. They can't permit an independent media that could expose their corruption. And they can't permit free and fair elections. Again, we just heard that the people who are bribing, Petrobras officials who are bribing the public officials in Brazil are also making illegal campaign contributions and financing elections that'll keep those they've already invested in office. Indignation at grand corruption is destabilizing many countries and in the process creating grave dangers for international peace and security. Young people around the world particularly no longer accept as a necessary fact of life corrupt high officials. We saw this in Egypt when people led by young people went to Tahrir Square and toppled Mubarak. We saw it in Ukraine where they went to Maidan and drove Yanukovych out of Ukraine, president of Ukraine, went to Russia. It triggered Russia's invasion of Crimea. It fundamentally challenged and altered the relationship between the EU and the United States and Russia, gravely complicating our efforts to deal with matters in Syria. So Secretary of State Kerry was surely correct when he said last year in Davos that the quality of governments is no longer a domestic concern. It's an international concern. It's important to realize that grand corruption doesn't flourish because of a lack of laws. 181 countries are party to the United Nations Convention Against Corruption, called the UNCAC. UNCAC requires those countries to have laws that make it a crime to engage in bribery, to engage in money laundering, to misappropriate national resources. The problem is that those laws are not enforced, particularly against the kleptocrats who rule those countries, because they control, in almost all of those countries, the police, the prosecutors, and the courts. And as I said, they will not permit the honest, effective investigation, prosecution, and punishment of their close colleagues and indeed themselves. Turkey is an example that's particularly close to my heart. In 2012 and 2013, I was working with some very honest, admirable judges who headed the Turkish Judicial Training Academy. They were trying to train the prosecutors and judges who in the kind of system Judge Moro is in, get trained together and sometimes go back and forth between being a prosecutor and a judge. It's an inquisitorial, not an adversarial system. But they were trying to train all of them to be more expert, more impartial, and more independent. Prosecutor made a series of cases against members of then Prime Minister Erdogan's cabinet. And he leaked, and I don't commend leaks, but a wiretap or a bug, well, a wiretap of Erdogan himself telling his son how to get $10 million out of the house before a search warrant that he was anticipating was executed there. So what happened? The prosecutor was fired. He was prosecuted himself for using the cases as an attempted coup. And my friends were initially demoted, removed from office. After the attempted coup last August, they were detained. Despite the best efforts of the United States government, we can't find them. So similar things happened to other opponents of corruption. Alexei Navalny in Russia was prosecuted several years ago on what were charges that had determined to, by prosecutors to be unfounded when he revealed that the chief prosecutor had expensive property in Prague and permanent residence status there. It was actually a violation of Russian law. They didn't lock him up. They've locked up his brother, and they still have his brother. But he continues to go out and run for mayor of Moscow. He got prosecuted again. He got arrested within the last couple weeks. And because he's been convicted of certain things, like disturbing the peace, he disqualified from running against President Putin. So basically, as Transparency International found years ago, while the UNCAC and other treaties require that not only countries have laws prohibiting bribery and other things, but they enforce them, the international community is focused excessively on whether those laws are enacted and not enough on whether they're enforced, and they aren't. So in 2002, the evils of genocide is revealed in Rwanda, former Yugoslavia, compelled the world to create the International Criminal Court, and I submit comparable consequences, costs, justify the creation of an international anti-corruption court, similar to but separate from the International Criminal Court, or ICC. It would be staffed, in my conception, by elite international investigators who could build on the excellent ability to follow the money for terrorists and drug financing that's developed since 9/11. It would be staffed by expert international prosecutors who can develop and prosecute complex cases and involve impartial international judges. It would operate like the ICC on the principle of complementarity. That means only officials of nations unwilling or unable to prosecute their own high officials would have those officials vulnerable to prosecution in the International Anti-Corruption Court. And this kind of international effort could actually strengthen domestic efforts. Years ago, a Spanish magistrate charged Pinochet, the president of Chile, who happened to be in London. He was eventually allowed to go back to Chile, but he was prosecuted there in a case that probably would never otherwise have been brought. And the International Anti-Corruption Court would provide a forum for the Navalny's of the world, the whistleblowers who develop evidence but can't have it used in their domestic courts. I'll quickly touch on some of the criticisms of this court. It has to be quick. The Heritage Foundation has criticized it as a violation of national sovereignty, which, A, for countries that joined the court and delegated, shared some of their sovereignty, it wouldn't be a violation. But in any event, as with the ICC, certain abuses justify violations of what have traditionally been considered national sovereignty. Sometimes argue that the International Criminal Court is not worthy of emulation. It has been ponderously slow, but the United States courts were very weak after 15 years. Our seminal case, Marbury versus Madison, Chief Justice Marshall declares that he has the authority to order Thomas Jefferson to deliver a judicial commission and engages in an elaborate legal fiction because he knows that Jefferson would ignore that order and the American people would support Jefferson. But by 1974, the American courts had earned the trust of the American people, and Richard Nixon knew that he had to turn over, he had to obey a Supreme Court order to turn over the Watergate tapes because the American people in Congress would not tolerate opposition, resistance. And finally, the most common point made to me these days is that this is an impossible ideal. That how are you going to get leaders of corrupt countries to sign up for this, submit to the jurisdiction. But if Professor Rotberg will permit me my homily, which is not the way I ended the paper, in our lifetimes, many of us have seen seemingly impossible things occur. The collapse of the Soviet Union, the fall of apartheid in South Africa. There are distinct campaigns that have been successful for the creation of the International Criminal Court. Jonathan Fanton at the MacArthur Foundation was an engine of that effort to create the Landmines Treaty, which took only 5 years outside the United Nations process, and to create this international money laundering regime. So there has been a lot of interest and support in the proposed court. It's been supported by the United Nations High Commissioner for Human Rights, by Transparency International, Human Rights Watch, Global Witness, leading international prosecutors, including Justice Richard Goldstone of South Africa, Luis Moreno Ocampo of Argentina. In April, Juan Manuel Santos, who received the Nobel Peace Prize last year, made Colombia the first country to support the court. But to me, more significantly, are some of the people that I've heard from in the last week or two. Igor Sobolev, a leader of the Maidan Revolution, who's the chair of the Anti-Corruption Committee in the Ukrainian Parliament. Claudia Escobar, a brave judge from Guatemala, who tape recorded a bribe, turned it over to Sisi, a hybrid anti-corruption effort, and now can no longer live in Guatemala, too dangerous. Alfredo Romero, whose organization represents thousands of political prisoners in Venezuela, and John Gathongo of Kenya, a very brave anti-corruption activist. So I think that with people like that, somehow they have the courage, the energy, the imagination to figure out how this can happen. And I will conclude by saying that I very much appreciate the opportunity to discuss a simple idea with powerful potential, I believe, to the members of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences who epitomize and personify faith in the power of ideas. Thank you very much.